أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن نبينا محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن سار على نهجهم واقتفى أثرهم وأحبهم وذب عنهم إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، أيها الجمع الكريم، أيها الإخوة الأفاضل، أيتها الأخوات الكريمات، أينما بلغ إليه أثير هذا اللقاء عبر هذه الوسائط والوسائل، فإني جميعا أحييكم بتحية الإسلام، تحية المؤمنين بعضهم بعضا، تحية ملائكة الله لعباده وأوليائه، تحية أهل الجنة يوم يدخلونها فيلقون ربهم جل وعلا فيها، كما قال سبحانه: تحيتهم يوم يلقونه سلام، فالسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. والله أسأل أن يجعل هذا اللقاء لقاء مباركا موفقا محققا للزلف لديه سبحانه بمرضاته، وأن يجعل هذا الاجتماع اجتماعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما، وأن لا يجعل فينا ولا معنا ولا من بيننا ولا من ورائنا شقيا ولا محروما. وبادئ ذي بدء أبشركم ببشارة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم التي ثبتت في الصحيح لكم ولأمثالكم، فقد ثبت عنه عليه الصلاة والسلام أنه قال: ما اجتمع قوم في بيت من بيوت الله يتلون كلام الله ويتذاكرونه بينهم، وفي رواية ويتدارسونه بينهم، إلا نزلت عليهم السكينة، هذه واحدة، وغشيتهم الرحمة، وهذه الثانية، وحفتهم الملائكة، وهذه الثالثة، وذكرهم الله جل وعلا في من عنده، وهذه الرابعة، إلا نزلت عليهم السكينة، وهذه السكينة بادية فيكم وعليكم، فاجتماعكم في هذا المسجد ليس كالاجتماع في الشوارع والنوادي والأسواق والطرقات بصخب ولغط، وإنما سكينة بادية فيكم وعليكم. وغشيتهم الرحمة، وهي رحمة أرحم الراحمين، لما اجتمعتم على ذكره وعلى مائدة شرعه ووحيه كان الجزاء وفاقا، هل جزاء الإحسان إلا الإحسان، فإنها تغشاكم رحمته لما اجتمعتم بسببه. وحفتهم الملائكة، الله له ملائكة سياحة في أرضه، وظيفتها استتباع مجالس العلم والذكر، فإذا رأت مجالس العلم نادى بعضها بعضا أن هلموا إلى مجالس الذكر فارتعوا. وبقيت الرابعة وأرجئها بعد الترجمة.
The Shaykh, after praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and giving the khutbatul haja, he said that I want to begin with the greeting of Islam, the greeting that the believers give to one another, the greeting that the angels of Allah give to his servants and his awliya, the greeting that the people of Jannah will receive when they enter into Jannah and when they meet their Lord. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, that their greeting on that day, the day that they meet their Lord, will be the salam. And then the Shaykh gave the salam to all of us. After that, he said that I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he makes this gathering and this sitting a gathering in which we achieve and attain the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it becomes a gathering by which we seek nearness and come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that he makes this a gathering upon which the people who attend this gathering will be people whom Allah showers His mercy upon. And that after we leave from this gathering, that Allah Azza wa Jal will make us leave having expiated our sins, and that there will be no one from amongst us or who is with us or who in any way is involved within this gathering, except that he will be a part of that blessing and a part of that invocation. The Shaykh said that I want to begin by giving you the glad tidings of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam that are mentioned in the Sahih of Imam al-Bukhari. And it is for you and for those people who are similar to you, whether you're sitting here or whether you're participating in this sitting in the masjid, however you are participating. The Shaykh said that there is the famous hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam that a group of people do not gather in one of the houses of the houses of Allah, in which they study the book of Allah, the verses of Allah, and they revise them or they study them amongst themselves, except that Allah Azza wa Jal will send upon them tranquility. The Shaykh said that's the first blessing. The second one is that then they will have the mercy of Allah envelop them. That's the second one. The third blessing is that the angels will come and surround them. And the fourth and final blessing is that Allah Azza wa Jal mentions those people with the highest and noblest of companionships. The Shaykh said, as for the tranquility being descended upon those people, it is something which you can see when you look around. It is something which is upon us and between us. This gathering is not like the gathering that you have when you meet on the roads and the streets, or when you meet in the marketplaces or anywhere else on earth. This is a gathering where you can see that there is tranquility. It is apparent that there is tranquility amongst the people that are sitting here today and now. And as for the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal that falls and is showered upon those people, then this is the mercy from the most merciful of those who show mercy. And this is because these people have come seeking the mercy of Allah, so Allah showers His mercy upon them. As Allah Azza wa Jal mentions in the Quran, and is the reward of goodness anything except goodness. And then the angels come and they surround them, because Allah Azza wa Jal has created a group of angels. Their only job, their only role and responsibility is to scour the earth and to search for these gatherings and circles of knowledge. And when they find them, they come and they surround them, and they stay there until those people disperse from those gatherings. And then we have the fourth one, and that is what the Shaykh is now going to go on to.
قال صلى الله عليه وسلم والرابعة وذكرهم الله جل وعلا في من عنده. لما ذكرنا الله فيما بيننا ذكرنا الله جل وعلا في ملأ خير منا وهم ملأه الأعلى في ملائكته المقربين. والجزاء من جنس العمل، ولهذا جاء في الصحيح قوله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال الله عز وجل أنا عند ظن عبدي بي فليظن بي عبدي ما شاء، وقال من ذكرني في نفسه ذكرته في نفسي، ومن ذكرني في ملأ ذكرته في ملأ خير منهم، لأن الله يقول جزاء وفاقا. من ذكر الله في نفسه تعظيما وحبا ورجاء ورغبة وعبودية ذكره الله جل وعلا في نفسه، في نفسه الشريفة. من ذكر الله في ملأ من ملأ الدنيا ذكرهم الله جل وعلا مادحا له مثنيا عليه في ملأه الأعلى في ملائكته المقربين. فنسأل الله ألا يحرمنا هذه الأربع ولا واحدة منها بمنه وكرمه، إنه سبحانه جواد كريم.
The Shaykh said, and as for the fourth of those benefits that were mentioned in the statement of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that is that these people are mentioned by Allah in the noblest and highest of companionships. When we remember Allah, when we speak about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah azza wa jal remembers us and He speaks of us in a companionship and a gathering and a sitting that is far greater and far better than what we have here. And that is because Allah azza wa jal rewards us with the goodness that we're doing. He rewards us with even better goodness, with that which is better many fold. And that's why the Prophet said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that Allah says in the hadith al-Qudsi that I am as my slave thinks of me, so let him think of me that which he wills. And in another hadith al-Qudsi, Allah Azza wa Jal says that whosoever remembers me in himself, I will remember him in myself. And whosoever remembers me in a gathering, I will remember him in a gathering which is far better and far greater. And so you reap what you sow. When you take that step towards Allah Azza wa Jal, then Allah Azza wa Jal rewards you accordingly. When you remember Allah out of love out of reverence, exalting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of hope in your meeting with Allah azza wa jal, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remembers you in His holy self. And when you remember Him in a group, in a gathering, then Allah azza wa jal remembers you in a far greater gathering with the noblest and greatest of His angels. So the Shaykh said that I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He grants us all four of these blessings, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't even prevent one of them from coming to us.
ونحن في بداية هذه المجالس العلمية أيها الجمع الكريم، ومنكم من قدم من أطراف هذا البلد ومن أطراف أوروبا، وأكد على مسألة مهمة وهي جليلة في قلب المؤمن يجب أن يعتني بها العناية اللائقة، ألا وهي تجريد النية وتحقيقها عبودية لله رب العالمين في احتساب وقته وما بذله من الجهد والمال ومفارقة الأولاد، أن يكون احتسابه في هذه المجالس النية عند الله جل وعلا أنه إنما جاء يبتغي ثوابه ونواله، وبهذا يدرك فلاح الدنيا وسعادة الآخرة، كما قال سبحانه وتعالى: من كان يريد الحياة الدنيا وزينتها نوفي إليهم أعمالهم فيها وهم فيها لا يبخسون أولئك الذين ليس لهم في الآخرة إلا النار وحبط ما صنعوا فيها وباطل ما كانوا يعملون. ولهذا عني العلماء بأمر النية في كل عبادة، ولما كان العلم أطول العبادات مدة كان تحري النية فيه وأثناءه من أهم الأمور وأوجبها وآكدها. ألا فصحح يا عبد الله نيتك، وحقق لله قصدك ومطيتك، وابتغي بهذا العمل ثواب ربك وثناءه ومدحته، لا ترجو غيره، تفلح في الدنيا وتفلح في الآخرة. والنية شأنها عظيم، ولهذا هي عبادة قلبية تدور عليها سائر العبادات. نعم.
The Sheikh said at the beginning of this conference, where we have many people that have come from all over the city and perhaps the country and maybe even beyond from other parts of Europe, I want to remind you of a very important issue, something that the believer holds dear and close to his heart. And that is something which is incumbent and obligatory upon him in all acts of worship. And that is that at the beginning of every act of worship, you purify your intention, making sure and ensuring that it is sincerely and purely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of your time that you spend here, every single minute, all of that effort that you've put into getting here, all of that money that you've spent so that you can be here, separating from your families or traveling from your families, whatever it may be, all of that, you make sure that your intention in all of that is to seek the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His pleasure alone. And if you do this and you seek His reward and His pleasure, then you will find that within this, you will have success not only in this life, but in the next life as well. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, whosoever seeks the life of this world, then we will give him his just recompense from the actions that he performs. And he won't find us to be from amongst those who are stingy or miserly, meaning that we will leave him to this world and what he intends from this world. These are the people that will not have any portion of the next life, of the hereafter, but rather their actions will be nullified and that which they used to do will not benefit and avail them. And that's why you find, the Shaykh said, that the scholars of Islam of the past, they used to place much emphasis and importance on this one single issue, and that is the issue of purifying your intention. And especially when it comes to seeking knowledge, because seeking knowledge, the Shaykh said, is the act of worship that is longest in terms of its length. You seek knowledge not just for a short while or a few minutes or a day, but it is something which continues with you for your lifetime. And because of this, it is important that you revise your intention at the beginning. So the Shaykh said that I advise you right now, right here, to look into your hearts and to purify your intentions, to make sure that they are sincere and pure for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that all that you want to seek from attending these lectures and this conference is the reward of Allah Azza wa Jal and His reward alone. And you don't care about anyone else or what they think or what they expect. If you do this, then you will achieve not only success in this life, but in the next life as well. And that's why sincerity is a great action of the heart. Upon it rests all of the other actions in this religion.
إن في سير العلماء المصلحين وفي سير أئمة الحق وأئمة السنة نبراس وتثبيت وتسلية للمؤمنين، وفي مقدم هؤلاء أنبياء الله ورسله عليهم الصلاة والسلام، كما قال جل وعلا: نحن نقص عليك من أنباء الرسل ما نثبت به فؤادك. تثبيت لفؤاد المؤمن وفؤاد النبي، لأنه إذا نظر في هؤلاء الصالحين في أحوالهم، في جهدهم وجهادهم، في علمهم وبذلهم ونفعهم عباد الله، أورثه ذلك السير على منواله والاهتداء بهديهم والاقتداء بهم. ولهذا في سورة الأنعام لما ذكر الله في موضع واحد أسماء 18 نبيا ورسولا قال في السياق: أولئك الذين هدى الله فبهداه مقتده. وهذا اللقاء في هذه الجلسة نتذاكر وإياكم على ما رغب الإخوان المنظمون لهذا المؤتمر مواقف من حياتي و مواقف شيخنا علامة هذا الزمان الشيخ عبد العزيز بن عبد الله بن باز المتوفى في سنة 1420 من الهجرة، لعلها أن تكون محفزة لنا في سلوك هذه الجادة، جادة أهل الإيمان وأهل السنة المترسمين منهج السلف الصالح، لعلنا أن نسير بكم وبهم، وأن يسلك الله جل وعلا بنا وبكم جميعا مسلك عباده وأوليائه الصالحين، إنه جواد كريم. وإلا فليس المقام مقام تعظيم، ليس المقام مقام تعظيم لشيخنا أو الغلو فيه أو رفعه عن منزلته، فإنه كان يحذرنا من ذلك ونحن نحذر من ذلك اتباعا لمنهج نبينا صلى الله عليه وسلم لما قال: لا تطروني كما أطرت النصارى ابن مريم، إنما أنا عبد فقولوا عبد الله ورسوله، ما أحب أن ترفعوني فوق منزلتي التي أنزل الله عليها. ولكن هذه الجادة في تذكر مواقف العلماء وسيرهم وأحوالهم وبذلهم، هذه الجادة جادة مطروقة من العلماء، بل وفي كتاب ربنا جل وعلا لما قص علينا خبر من قبلنا من الأمم وجهاد أنبيائهم لهم، نسلك بهذا المسلك هذا الطريق، لعل الله أن ينفعنا وإياكم بها على ما يعن به الخاطر من استحضار بعض هذه المواقف، وإلا فإني أعتذر إليكم عن استيعابها كلها، وإنما سأذكر من هذه المواقف ما شهدته بعيني أو سمعته بأذني من شيخي رحمه الله. نعم.
The Shaykh said that to continue indeed in studying the lives and the biographies of the scholars of Islam and the Imams of the Sunnah and the Imams of this religion, there is much light to be gathered and attained, and there is also much benefit to be taken in terms of learning our methodology, learning the path that we need to be on. And the greatest of those biographies, the greatest of those examples is the example of the prophets of Allah and his messengers alayhim as-salatu was-salam. As Allah Azza wa Jalla says in the Quran that indeed we relate to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from their stories in truth, so that we may make your heart firm, so that we may give your heart firmness. And so this is something which we do when we study the lives of the scholars of Islam. We look at their efforts, we look at their worship, we look at their knowledge, we look at their struggles, we look at all of their lives so that we can benefit from them, so that it may inspire us to follow their path and to follow their way. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to do in the Quran, when in Surah Al-An'am he mentioned 18 of his prophets by name, 18 of his prophets and messengers by name, and then he said towards the end of those verses that indeed those are the ones that Allah guided, so take from their guidance, benefit from that guidance that Allah Azza wa Jal gave to them. So in this lecture tonight, in this sitting inshallah ta'ala, the Shaykh said that we're going to go through some of my experiences and some of my situations that took place with me and my Shaykh Ibn Baz rahimahullahu ta'ala, who died in the year 1420 of the Hijrah. And this isn't to, the Shaykh said, this is so that a person can know how to follow the example of those scholars who came before us, so that we know how to follow that path of truthfulness, that we can follow the example of the Salafus Salih, the righteous predecessors who came before us. The Shaykh said that this isn't to go into extremes in praising our Shaykh or to raise him above the level that he has, because the Shaykh himself, Shaykh bin Baz rahimahullah, would warn us against this. And the Shaykh said, and we also warn against this, because our Prophet told us sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, don't go to extremes in praising me just as the Christians did with the son of Mary, but rather I am the slave of Allah, so say that I am the slave of Allah and his messenger. And in the other hadith he said that I don't like that you should raise me above the station that Allah Azza wa Jal placed for me. So based on this hadith, this lecture isn't to overly praise or exalt the Shaykh beyond his status, but it is rather so that we can benefit from his life, benefit from his methodology, knowledge and worship and his character and so on and so forth, so that we too also can be inspired to follow his example, to take and benefit from that which we found him to be upon. And the Shaykh said that what I will mention to you today is only a small portion of the life of the Shaykh and the many things that took place during his life, but it is something which, or some of the things that I will mention, are those things which I saw with my own eyes or I heard with my own ears.
شيخنا رحمه الله أخبرنا عن شيوخه الذين استفاد منهم العلم، وكان أجل شيوخه في عينه شيخه الشيخ محمد بن إبراهيم ابن عبد اللطيف ابن عبد الرحمن ابن حسن ابن الشيخ المجدد محمد بن عبد الوهاب. يقول رحمه الله: لازمته 10 سنين فلم ترى عيني قبل أن يذهب بصرها، ولم أسمع عن شيخ أعلم ولا أحسن تدريسا منه ولا أنفع للطالب في تعليمه. وقد تأثر شيخنا بشيخه كثيرا، وكان لا يذكره إلا وتدمع عيناه، إجلالا لشيخه وحبا له وترسما لطريقته. وهكذا يا أيها الإخوة، إذا احترم الطالب شيخه وأجله عظم انتفاعه منه، وإذا قل اهتمام واحترام الطالب بشيخه قلت انتفاعه واستفادته منه، مع أن لشيخنا شيوخ كثر. سألته عن شيخه الشيخ سعد ابن الشيخ حمد بن عتيق، أخذت عنه العلم؟ قال: نعم، أدركته وهو كبير في السن، وقرأت عليه شيئا يسيرا ولم أكثر لأنه كان ضعيف القوى. وهنا أنبه على مسألة تتعلق بكف البصر، فإن كثيرا من الناس يظن أن شيخنا كف بصره وهو صغير، وهذا ليس بصحيح، فإن الشيخ كما أخبرنا أنه لما كان صغيرا كان يلعب بالطيور يسمونها كز الطير، يذهب إلى مكان بعيد ثم يرسل طيره، ومن وصل طيره إلى عشه الأول فهو الفائز، وهذه لا يعملها إلا من كان مبصرا. بدأ بشيخنا ضعف البصر وهو في سن 15 في سن 15 في آخرها، وما زال الضعف يزداد ببصره إلى أن كف بصره وهو ابن 19 سنة. ولهذا كان يكتب الحروف بيده، يقول الباء هكذا والألف هكذا، يكتبها لنا بيده وهو كفيف، فهو لم يكف بصره إلا لما جاوز البلوغ رحمه الله بعدما أتم حفظ القرآن. فقد صلى بالناس إماما صلاة التراويح وعمره 17 سنة في سنة 1347، وهي السنة المشهورة في تاريخنا بسنة السبلة. يقول تلك أول سنة أصلي بالناس صلاة التراويح حفظا، لأن الناس كانوا ذاهبين للغزو. المقصود من هذا هو الأخذ عن المشايخ والاستفادة منهم، وكان أجل العلماء في عين شيخنا هو شيخه مفتي الديار ورئيس القضاة وكبير علمائنا الشيخ محمد بن إبراهيم بن عبد اللطيف بن عبد الرحمن بن حسن ابن الشيخ المجدد محمد بن عبد الوهاب، سليل هذه الدعوة الإصلاحية الموفقة المباركة. نعم.
الشيخ said that his شيخ شيخ بن باز رحمه الله تعالى would often speak about his own teachers, his own شيخs, the people that he studied with. And the person or the شيخ that he used to most speak about and the one that he was affected by the most, the one that he would remember fondly the most was his main شيخ and his main teacher, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Ibrahim al-Sheikh, who is from the descendants of Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab rahimahumullah ta'ala. And the Sheikh said that he studied with him, Sheikh bin Baz studied with his Sheikh, his teacher Sheikh Muhammad ibn Ibrahim for 10 years. And he used to say that I never saw anyone, and this was before he became blind, I never saw anyone nor did I hear or benefit from anyone more knowledgeable and better and more beneficial for the student of knowledge than this Sheikh. And the Sheikh used to love him a lot. The Sheikh bin Baz, Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah, used to love his teacher a lot. Even after his death, he used to love him to the extent, and he used to revere him and respect him to the extent that when he would remember him and when he would speak about him, his eyes would moisten and he would begin to cry because of the station that he had within his heart, because of how much he loved him. And the Sheikh said, Sheikh Ali said, that this gives us an important lesson about how important it is for the student to respect and to love his teacher, to honor his teacher. And the Sheikh said that the more that the student loves and respects and honors his teacher, the greater he will benefit from him. And the less that he honors his teacher and respects him, the less that he will take and he will benefit from him. Because Sheikh bin Baz had many teachers, rahimahullah. He had many teachers. Sheikh Ali says that I asked him concerning another of his teachers by the name of Sheikh Sa'ad al-Atiq. And he said, yes, I studied with him, but he was at a very old age at that time. And because of his weakness, because he was old in age and he was weak, I didn't study much with him, but I only recited or read to him from a few places here and there. And the Sheikh said that he wants to point out another important issue here, and that is that many people think that Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah was born blind. But in fact, this wasn't true. He was born and he had normal eyesight. And when he was young, he used to play with other children in his age, and he used to play a game with birds, where they used to go out in the desert and they used to set their birds free. And the one who won was the bird that went back to its nest first. Whoever's bird went back to its nest first, he was the one that won. The Sheikh used to play these types of games when he was young. The Sheikh, his eyesight began to weaken at the age of 15. And so he had memorized the Quran and he already knew how to read and write and so on. It was at the age of 15 when his eyesight began to become weak. And he only became blind, he only lost his eyesight when he reached the age of 19. And that's why Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah used to say about himself that I led the people in Taraweeh prayer when I was 17 years old, in the year 1347 of the Hijrah, in the year 1347 of the Hijrah. So the Sheikh would see and he would write, and Sheikh Ali says that he would, even afterwards when he was blind, when they used to study with him, he used to write letters. He would write the letters to show them that he knew how to write, he knew the letters. So he would draw them to show that he had learned these letters, he knew how to write, but then afterwards he lost his eyesight. The Sheikh said that the whole point of this is to show the importance of how one should respect and honor his teachers, and how Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah used to honor his teachers and respect them and love them even after their deaths, and especially his main Sheikh, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Ibrahim al-Sheikh rahimahullah.
بقي في مسألة شيوخ الشيخ مسألتان أنبه عليهما. المسألة الأولى في الإجازات التي يعتني بها الآن بعض الطلبة ويفرغون لها همتهم ويكثرون من جمعها وتحصيلها، بل يسافر المسافة الطويلة حتى يلقى من يجيزه وإن لم يأخذ عنه علما. ما كان شيخنا رحمه الله يرى للإجازات قيمة، وقال إنها لا تنفع في العلم كثيرا، وذكر أن هذه الإجازات أنها لا تدل على تحصيل علم، وإنما هي شرف لصاحبه إن استقام على دين الله معظما سنة نبي الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. ولهذا لا أعرف أن شيخنا طلب الإجازة من أحد، بل أحد العلماء الهنود في المدينة أجاز شيخنا في الكتب الستة وشيخنا لم يطلب منه الإجازة، ولا أعرف أن شيخنا أجاز أحدا بهذه الإجازات التي حصلها، إنما الإجازة بالعلم بذله وتعليمه والعمل به. يحدثنا رحمه الله عن موقف حصل منه في أوائل الطلب وكان صغيرا، يقول: قد ناهزت البلوغ، وإن أول شيخ درست عليه العلم الشيخ صالح بن عبد العزيز آل الشيخ، ليس معالي الوزير الذي، لأن هذا في طبقة أبناء الشيخ، ولكن الشيخ صالح بن عبد العزيز آل الشيخ كان قاضيا في الرياض، قال شيخنا، وكان مجاورا لبيتنا وهو إمام مسجدنا يسمى مسجد بن شلوان. يقول شيخنا رحمه الله، وهذه أريدك أن تنتبه لها يا طالب العلم، يقول شيخنا: تأخرت يوما عن صلاة الظهر وكنت أدرس على هذا الشيخ، وقد فاتني من الظهر ركعتان، فلما انصرف الشيخ وهو الإمام الشيخ صالح بن عبد العزيز آل الشيخ انصرف من الصلاة، قمت أكمل الركعتين الباقيتين علي حتى إذا أتممتهما وشيخي يرمقني بعينه، فلما فرغت من الصلاة أشار إلي أن أقدم، فقدمت وجلست عنده، فقال: يا عبد العزيز، لا يليق بطالب العلم أن يقضي الصلوات أو يقضي الركعات، بل اللائق به أن يكون المبادر إلى أداء الصلاة في أول وقتها في الصفوف الأول، هذا هو اللائق بطالب العلم. يقول شيخنا: فما زالت كلماته ترن في أذني، ترن في أذني، ولا أذكر أني بعدها تخلفت عن الصلاة أو قضيت شيئا من ركعاتها. هذا الشأن العالم أنه يربي المتعلمين، ليس فقط محض معلومات يسديها لهم، ولكن يربيهم. ولهذا كان ثني الركب عند مجالس العلماء لأخذ العلم والسمت بهذا العلم والتأدب بأدبه والتخلق بأخلاقه. لما عطف الناس على أن العلم معلومات صار العلم في قلوبهم قليل البركة قليل النفع، لكن فائدة الأخذ عن المشايخ الثقات المأمونين في دينهم وعقيدتهم هو أن تتأسى بهم وأن يقودوك إلى هذا الطريق الواضح، طريق النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وطريقة أصحابه. نعم.
The Sheikh said that when it comes to the studying of Sheikh Ibn Baz rahimahullah ta'ala and his teachers, the Sheikh said that I want to mention two more points. The first of them is with regards to the ijazat, or the permissions that a person gets, the written permissions that a person gets from some of the shuyukh or from some of his teachers, which today in our time many people give a lot of weight and importance to, where they go and they travel and they get these ijazat, these permissions, these written permissions from teachers of or shuyukh when it comes to books of hadith or other than this. The Sheikh said that Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah ta'ala didn't used to place a lot of importance. He would not place a lot of importance and emphasis on this. But rather he would say that these permissions don't really mean that a person has studied. Rather, he means that he went and he met the Sheikh, and the Sheikh just gave him this piece of paper. Doesn't mean that he actually studied with him. And that's why these papers are only valuable if that person who took them actually studied and he learnt and he is firm upon the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he knows his religion. Then it is good. And that's why the Sheikh says that he doesn't know the Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah ta'ala ever asked anyone to give him these types of permissions, or he took them from his sheikhs, or he would ask other scholars that he met to give him these written permissions or these written permissions of hadith and so on. He wouldn't do this. In fact, even when the Sheikh was in Medina, and one of the Indian scholars, the scholars from India who's also in Medina, he actually gave Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah one of these permissions that was based upon the six books of hadith, Bukhari, Muslim and so on. These six books of hadith, he gave him a written permission, even though the Sheikh never requested it. And Sheikh Ali says that I don't think that the Sheikh ever passed this on to anyone else. He wouldn't place a lot of importance in this, but rather he would say that knowledge is taken by studying and by effort and by revising and by going to the scholars and learning at their feet and studying with them. The second issue that took place was when Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah ta'ala was young in age, when he first began to seek knowledge, and he was just at the age of puberty, of maturity, when he was just entering that age. The first sheikh that he benefited from was a sheikh by the name of Salih bin Abdul Aziz al-Sheikh rahimahullah ta'ala, not the sheikh Salih al-Sheikh that's living now, who's one of the students of Sheikh bin Baz, but rather this was one of the older sheikhs who passed away, and he was one of the judges of Medina, and he was also the imam of the masjid where the sheikh used to pray when he was young. He was a neighbor of the sheikh, and he used to be the imam of that masjid, and the sheikh used to go and study with him. He was his first teacher. He says that Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah was narrating the story to him or to them, and he said that when I was young, I once went to the masjid for the dhuhr prayer, but I was late and I missed the first two rak'ahs. And the Sheikh Ali said that I want you to pay attention to this story. He said I missed the two rak'ahs, and his sheikh was the imam of the masjid, he's leading the prayer. When he finished the prayer and he turned around, he obviously saw Sheikh bin Baz stand up and pray two more rak'ahs, finish and complete the prayer. When Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah had finished the prayer, the Sheikh called him. He looked at him and he caught his eye and he told him to come to the front. And then he said to him, "Oh Abdul Aziz," referring to Sheikh bin Baz, right? He's a young boy at this time. He said, "Oh Abdul Aziz, it is not befitting for the student of knowledge to come late to the prayer and to make up rak'ahs. But rather what is befitting for the student of knowledge is that he should be there early to the prayer, and he should be the one in the front rows." The Sheikh said, Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah, he said, from the moment that he said that, those words have stayed with me from that time. And he said that I never was late to another prayer after that. This is when the Sheikh is like maybe 11, 12 years old. He's saying for the rest of his life that a time never came when I was late for the prayer again, because I remembered those words of my Sheikh. The Sheikh Ali, Jazakallah Khair, he was saying that the benefit of this, the point of this, what we take from this, is how a teacher, the Sheikh, doesn't just teach his student information, doesn't just give him bits of information, but rather he nurtures his character. Rather he gives him mannerisms and character, he grounds him in more than just the information that he gives him. And that's why the scholars of the past, when they would travel to study with the scholars, they wouldn't just go to take from the knowledge, but they would also go to take from their etiquettes, from their mannerisms, from their character. They would benefit from both. And that's why today, the Sheikh is saying today, when people have become too over preoccupied with just information and they've forgot this other part of studying with that Sheikh in order to take from his character and etiquette and so on, that is when people have lost the blessing of knowledge. But rather what the scholars would do was that they would take both. They would learn from their Sheikh, and the Sheikh would not just teach them, but he would nurture them and he would educate them and he would give them a good tarbiyah, and this is what the student of knowledge is in need of.
كان شيخنا رحمه الله شديد العناية في حفظ وقته ألا يفرط منه شيء في غير منفعة، وكان مسخرا وقته للعبادة ولتعليم العلم ولنفع الناس. أذكر موقفين يدلان على هذا الأمر. كان إذا سافر رحمه الله إلى مكة أو إلى الطائف في فترة الصيف يحب أن يسافر بطريق البر، وكان يأمر مستشاريه أن يقرأوا عليه المعاملات الواردة إليه في الاستفتاء من الناس في حل المشاكل في أمر مشكل على أصحاب الفضيلة القضاة أو غيرهم في أمور تتعلق بالنفع العام. يقول لي أحد المستشارين: كنا في وقت الربيع والطريق من الرياض إلى مكة فيه نبت الربيع لأثر الأمطار التي قدمت، والشيخ يقرأ يأمرنا بالقراءة. يقول: فضاقت صدورنا، قلنا: يا شيخ، ودنا نستمتع بهذه الأجواء ونستمتع بهذه الأشجار وهذه الشجيرات وهذا الربيع، وأنت يا شيخ ما تشوف، نريد أن نستمتع نحن. فضحك شيخنا وقال: لا بأس لا بأس، وتركهم. واشتغل الشيخ رحمه الله بعد ذلك بالتسبيح والتهليل والاستغفار: سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر. حتى أخذوا من الليل في الطريق مأخذا ونزلوا متعبين، ورقد الناس قبل أن يصلوا إلى الطائف، فانتبه أحدهم وإذا بالشيخ قائم يصلي في هزيع من الليل، ما أخذ منه التعب كما أخذ من أصحابه ورفقته وهم في طريق سفر. أنتم الآن في هذا المجلس بعضكم يتململ وبعضكم ربما ينعس، والشأن في ما يجعله الإنسان في قلبه في هجيرة. الموقف الثاني الذي يدل على حفظ شيخنا للوقت موقف حصل لنا معه، فإني قدمت عليه ومعنا المشايخ من الرياض، وكان في الطائف في فترة الصيف، ويبقى في الطائف نحو من 4 أشهر. فدعانا إلى الغداء معه فاستجبنا له، ومن توفيق الله لنا في ذلك اليوم أن المجلس ما كان كبيرا بحضوره، فقلنا: اليوم نستمتع بشيخنا ومذاكرته ومباحثته. ونحن ننتظر الغداء قريبا من 50 دقيقة قدم لنا، سألنا الشيخ ما عندنا من أسئلة واستشكالات ومباحثات، وسألنا عن الدعوة وما نحن مقدمون عليه وما نحن ذاهبون إليه، ووصانا أن نتجه إلى جنوب المملكة لدعوة الناس، وقبلنا توجيهه. وفي تلك الجلسة عرض علي رحمه الله إكمال عمله في فتح الباري، لأني سألته: ما عندكم نية يا سماحة شيخنا في إكمال عملكم في فتح الباري بالتعليق على المؤاخذات والملاحظات الواردة فيه؟ قال: والله أنا انشغلت عنه شغلا عظيما ولا أستطيعه الآن، لكن أنت استعن بالله وأكملها. قلت: بشرط أن أعرضها عليك. فوافق. قدم لنا تمر رطب من تمر المدينة من الروثانة، والشيخ رحمه الله بعد الظهر يأكل التمر بعد الفجر، فأكلنا منها حبات، ثم دارت القهوة. فقال: يؤانسنا يذكرون أن هذا النوع من أفخر تمور المدينة، تمر الروثانة، وأنا باعتبار أني من مواليد المدينة ونشأت بها على صاحبها أفضل الصلاة وأزكى التسليم. قلت: هو كذلك يا سماحة شيخنا، وفي المدينة أكثر من 60 صنفا. فقال: سبحان الله. ثم ذكرنا فائدة، قال: ذكر ابن الجوزي في كتابه المنتظم في أخبار الأمم أن في العراق، وما أدراكم ما شأن العراق الآن. قال شيخنا: إن ابن الجوزي ذكر أن في العراق أكثر من 600 صنف من أصناف التمور. وتكلمنا في التمر مع الشيخ نحو من 10 دقائق، فرمى رحمه الله برأسه مستغفرا، ثم رفع رأسه، قال: من يقرأ علينا شيئا من القرآن؟ فقرأ أحد المشايخ سورة القيامة كاملة، ولما بلغ قول الله جل وعلا: وجوه يومئذ ناظرة إلى ربها ناظرة، خشعت عينه، وخشع شيخنا أيضا ودمعت عيناه وخشعنا. فلما فرغ من قراءة السورة كاملة علق عليها شيخنا من أولها إلى آخرها. فانتبهنا أننا لما تكلمنا في التمر وأنواعه وأصنافه وفواخره نحو من 10 دقائق وهو أمر يتعلق بالدنيا صرفنا وحفظ وقتنا فأرجعنا إلى زكاة العلم وزكاة الروح في التعلق بالباقي لا بالفاني، بالآجل لا بالعاجل. فعمر المجلس بقراءة القرآن وعمر بتفسيره وإثبات رؤية الله في الدار الآخرة من أوليائه، وهذا قل أن ينتبه له الإنسان خصوصا إذا ضاعت الأوقات فيما لا ينفع. هذا إذا سلمت من أن تكون الأوقات فيما يضر الإنسان في عاقبته وفي آجلته. نعم
الشيخ صدر وصف مري الصوان بنفر from his الشيخ شيخ بن باز رحمه الله تعالى was that he was extremely eager when it came to preserving his time, didn't like to waste his time, but he would only spend his time either in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or spreading knowledge and teaching or something else which was beneficial to the people. The Shaykh said that I will mention two examples of this. The first of them is that the Shaykh would often travel from Riyadh, where he used to live, to Mecca or to Ta'if, and in Ta'if he would spend the summer months, maybe 3 to 4 months every single year. But if he traveled, he would like to travel by car, by land. He wouldn't like to fly, but he would like to go by car. And he would travel with his advisors and his secretaries, and he would make them read to him throughout the whole trip. They would read people's questions so that he could respond to them, problems that are happening between people, different issues that were coming to him. He would like that they should read so that he could respond to them and that he could answer them. The Shaykh Sheikh Ali said that one of those advisors, one of his secretaries, told us once that whilst they were going on one of these trips from Riyadh to Ta'if, and it's a long trip, takes many hours to get to Ta'if from Riyadh, it was in the time of spring, and there had been rain that had come in the country, and so on the way they could see greenery. They could see that there were flowers and there was greenery and the trees were coming back to life and so on and so forth. And the Shaykh is asking them to read. The secretary says that we wanted to look outside, wanted to look at the window, wanted to enjoy the scenery and so on. But the Shaykh is saying, read, read, read. He wants to go through his correspondence and the many issues that are coming to him. So they said to the Shaykh after a while, they said, Shaykh, it's nice weather. It's been raining, there's scenery, there's greenery. We want to enjoy our trip. And you, Shaykh, you don't see anyway, you're blind. So you can't really benefit from this, but we can. So why don't you let us do it? So the Shaykh laughed and he said, okay, go ahead. So whilst they were doing this, the Shaykh busied himself with making dhikr. Throughout the whole trip, he just began to make dhikr, say Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, throughout the whole trip. The advisor says that we stopped halfway for the night, we rested, and then the next day we were going to carry on. So everyone was tired, they stopped at a place, and everyone went to sleep. He said, but before everyone else went to sleep, I wanted to check up on the Shaykh to make sure he was okay, and I found that he was praying during the night. Everyone else is tired, everyone else has gone to sleep, and all they were doing was watching scenery. The Shaykh was busy with making dhikr, and now that it's come to a portion of the night, the Shaykh doesn't sleep, but he stays awake. And he prays during that night, and this is how the Shaykh used to love to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and benefit from his time. The second thing that took place, or the second incident, is something which the Shaykh himself personally witnessed. And again it was in the city of Al-Ta'if, where the Shaykh would spend his summer months, Shaykh bin Baz rahimahullah. Shaykh Ali says that a group of us, we went from Riyadh to visit the Shaykh in Al-Ta'if, and the Shaykh invited us for lunch at his house. So we went, and on that day there weren't many people that were invited. There was only a small group of people. So they became happy because they wanted to go and ask him questions and benefit from him and study with him and revise with him. And so they ended up spending about 50 minutes waiting for the lunch to come, revising with the Shaykh and speaking to the Shaykh and asking him questions and taking advice from him. And the Shaykh advised him they should go to the south of the country and to give da'wah there and to benefit the Muslims that are in that part of the country and so on. And in that sitting, the Shaykh says, Shaykh Ali says, the Shaykh bin Baz said to me, why don't you complete my annotations of Fath al-Bari? Shaykh bin Baz rahimahullah had began to annotate on Fath al-Bari, which is the explanation of Sahih al-Bukhari, the book by Ibn Hajar rahimahullah ta'ala. He had begun to make annotations on that explanation. But then he became busy with many of his other chores and responsibilities, and he wasn't able to complete it. So he asked Sheikh Ali to complete it. So the Sheikh agreed, but he said on one condition, and that condition is that once I finish, I read it to you, and you give me your feedback. You approve what I have written and what I have done. And the Sheikh agreed to do so. And it was the practice and the habit of the Sheikh that he would eat dates after the Fajr prayer and after Dhuhr prayer. So whilst they were waiting for lunch to come, they began to eat dates, and the dates that they had were from the dates of Medina. And the Sheikh began to give the dates out, and he began to give them coffee and so on. And he told them that these dates are from the dates of Medina, and these dates are something which are considered to be one of the best types of dates that you find in Medina. Sheikh Ali said that I said to the Sheikh, because I was born in Medina, I grew up in Medina, I know Medina, I said to the Sheikh that there are 60 different various types of dates that you find in Medina. Just as a point of benefit, he told the Sheikh that there are 60 different types of dates that you find in the city of Medina. So the Sheikh replied, and he said that Ibn al-Jawzi rahimahullah, one of the scholars of the past, he said that in Iraq, if you go to Iraq, there are over 600 types of dates. 600 different types of dates that you can find in the country of Iraq. The Sheikh said, then after this, again not wanting to waste his time or let the time pass by, he asked his students, one of them, to recite the Quran. So one of the students began to recite. And it's as if the Sheikh is saying, Sheikh Ali said, it's as if the Sheikh, now that they had spoken about dates and the dunya and the world, the Sheikh wanted to take them back to remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one of the students began to recite Surah Al-Qiyamah, and he finished the whole surah. And when he reached the verse in the surah in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that on that day their faces will be bright because they will be looking upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Sheikh began to cry. And he became humbled at this verse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then after the brother finished reciting the whole of the surah, the Sheikh began to explain the surah and make his tafsir of the surah. So Sheikh Ali is saying this is how the Sheikh would benefit from his time. Even when they would talk about something as easy as dates or just the different types of dates you can get, he would always bring everyone back to the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the recitation of the Quran. He would always connect the hearts of the people to the next life and to that which is more permanent in this temporary abode, and how the believers on that day, they will see their Lord, inshallah.
Shaykhuna rahimahullah, Shaykh ibn Baz, كان سريع الدمعة كثير الخشوع والتأثر ولا سيما في أربع مواقف. الموقف الأول عند تعظيم الله عز وجل في شواهد الأدلة في القرآن والسنة، التفت إليه وإذا عيناه تدمعان مع لهج لسانه بتعظيم الله، لا إله إلا الله، سبحان الله والحمد لله والله أكبر. فإذا مر موقف فيه تعظيم لله جل وعلا خشع قلبه وتأثرت عيناه وبكى. من مواقع تأثره أيضا التي نراها كثيرا في دروسه في مواقفه، حادثة الإفك التي وقعت لأم المؤمنين عائشة رضي الله عنها، وفي قراءتها من زاد المعاد كان شيخنا رحمه الله يكثر البكاء والنحيب إذا ذكر ابن القيم ما جرى لأمنا عائشة، ولا سيما ما ثبت في الصحيحين من سرد هذه القصة، ويرفع صوته داعيا بالترضي عليها وداعيا على من نال منها. من مواقف تأثره أيضا رحمه الله يتأثر إذا ذكرت عنده مآسي المسلمين المعاصرة وما يقع عليهم في بلدانهم من تسلط أعدائهم عليهم وحلول البأساء والضراء بهم، يتأثر بهذا كثيرا، ولا سيما ما يجري على إخواننا في ذلك الوقت إلى الآن في فلسطين الجريحة. موقف الرابع تأثر به شيخنا إذا ذكر شيخه هو الشيخ محمد بن إبراهيم، فإنه في مجلس مخصوص بطلبة العلم سألوه عن شيوخه وعن أكثر من تأثر بهم، فذكر جملة من شيوخه ثم ذكر شيخه الشيخ محمد بن إبراهيم وبكى. وهذا البكاء والله أعلم لما لشيخه في قلبه من المكانة ولما له عليه من الأثر ولما له عليه من الحق. وهذه ناحية أعني في التأثر الذي يظهر، أصل التأثر في القلب لكن يظهر على الجوارح، على اللسان وعلى دمع العين، وربما في نحيب الإنسان في بكائه. وكانت هذه المواقف من أشد ما يكون تأثيرا علينا نحن الطلبة، لا سيما إذا مر في مواضع تعظيم الله عز وجل، فإنه يتأثر ويبكي ويبكينا في مجالس العلم. وليس لهذا المقام للتصنع فيه مجالا، وإنما هو ظهور لما كان في القلب من تعظيم الله وإجلاله، أو التأثر لما يقع للمسلمين. نعم.
The Sheikh said that also from what he saw and benefited from his Sheikh, Sheikh Ibn Baz, rahimahullah ta'ala, was that he would be someone who would cry a lot and someone that was soft of heart. And especially when in four circumstances or four things that would often happen, they would make him cry often. The first of those things was the way that he would exalt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If someone was reading to him and they came across verses of the Quran or a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in which Allah is glorified and exalted, this was something which would often make the Shaykh rahimahullah cry. And he would often make him cry, and at the same time he would begin to make dhikr and praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and say the shahada and so on. This is something which would have a lot of impact upon him and upon his heart, and you could see plainly in his eyes that he would be crying because of his glorification of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second thing that would often make him cry is the story of the slander of our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, especially if that story was being read from the work of Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah Zadul Ma'ad, or if it was being read from the two sahihs of Imam al-Bukhari and Imam Muslim. That story and what took place to our mother Aisha radiallahu anha would often make him cry, and when he would read this he would begin to ask Allah to shower his blessings upon our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, and he would make dua against those people who slandered her as well. And so this is something which would also make him cry. The third thing that would often make him cry was the situation of the Muslims in different lands, the oppression that they were facing, the torture, the persecution. When he would hear of what's going on in different countries and what's taking place with the Muslims, especially in Palestine during that time, and even till today with the situation in Palestine, this is often something which would bring tears to his eyes, and he would often become saddened at this. And the fourth thing that would often make him cry was, as we mentioned before, when he used to remember his own Sheikh, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Ibrahim al-Sheikh rahimahullahu ta'ala. The Sheikh says that we remember once we were sitting with him in a private sitting where only his students were allowed, and Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah was speaking and reminiscing about his teachers, and then when he mentioned Sheikh Muhammad ibn Ibrahim rahimahullah, he began to cry. And this is because of the respect and the love that he had for him in his heart. And so this is something which the Sheikh says that we benefited from him. We would see him, and we would see that this wasn't just something which he was making up, something which he was faking or pretending to do, but we could tell that this is something which has softened his heart, and the effects of that softening of the heart would be plain to see in his eyes and on his tongue as well, when he would remember Allah, and especially when he would speak about Allah and he would praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and exalt him and magnify him and glorify him subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is something which would often drive him to tears.
أظننا أطلنا على الإخوان. أطلنا عليكم يا إخواني.
The Sheikh said, "Have we gone on for too long?"
يعني أطلنا أو لم نطل. كم تحتاجون من الوقت؟
How much more time do you give him?
ترانا في أول الطريق. الآن بدأنا.
The Sheikh said he's only at the beginning.
ما رأيكم أن نختصرها في أربعة مواقف؟
Sheikh said he'll mention just four more points or four more situations.
فيها بركة.
Inshallah, there's some blessing in this.
من المواقف لشيخنا رجوعه إلى الحق ورجوعه عن القول الذي كان يفتي به إذا تبين له أنه خلاف الراجح. وأذكر له في هذا مسألتان. المسألة الأولى، كان يفتي رحمه الله بجواز صرف الزكاة في المشاريع الخيرية كبناء المساجد والمراكز وتيسير الدعاة وبناء المستشفيات وحفر الآبار، المشاريع الخيرية والدعوية، كان يفتي رحمه الله بجواز دفع الزكاة إليها على أنها من عموم قول الله جل وعلا وفي سبيل الله. ثم إنه رجع عن هذا القول لما تباحث مع المشايخ ودرسوا هذا الموضوع في هيئة كبار العلماء، فأفتى بأنه لا يصرف مصرف الزكاة في سبيل الله إلا في الجهاد في سبيل الله ودواعيه، ولا يصرف في بقية الأعمال الدعوية والخيرية من بناء المساجد والمراكز وطبع الكتب وما إلى ذلك. وهذا كثير تأتينا المسألة ونسأله عن رأيه فيها، خصوصا المسائل المستجدة، فيقول انتظروا حتى نبحثها مع إخواننا أصحاب الفضيلة المشايخ ونصدر نحن وإياهم برأي واحد. وهذا من أفراد رجوعه رحمه الله إلى الحق. من المواقف أيضا أن شيخنا كان يسمي نفسه وهو في المدينة لما كان نائبا لرئيس الجامعة الإسلامية، وقد تولى نيابتها من سنة 1381 سنة إنشاء الجامعة إلى سنة 1395، كان نائبا لرئيسها، ورئيسها هو شيخه الشيخ محمد إبراهيم آل الشيخ. لما كان شيخنا في المدينة كان يتسمى هكذا: عبد العزيز بن عبد الله بن باز الأثري. عبد العزيز بن عبد الله بن باز الأثري، يضيف وصف الأثري. ثم لما رجع إلى الرياض متوليا رئاسة إدارات البحوث العلمية والإفتاء والدعوة والإرشاد، حذف كلمة الأثري، فسألته عن ذلك فقال إن هذا الوصف يوصف به الإنسان ولا يتسمى به، والسنة أن ينتسب الإنسان إلى أبيه وجده الأعلى والأدنى، فإن نبينا يقول أنا النبي لا كذب، أنا ابن عبد المطلب. ولم يستحسن أن يتصف بهذا الوصف، بأن يصف نفسه أو يسمي نفسه بالأثري أو بالسلفي أو بالقرآن أو بالحديث أو بغير ذلك، وإنما يتسمى باسمه واسم آبائه، فترك الانتساب إلى الأثري وانتسب إلى آبائه عبد العزيز بن عبد الله بن باز، وقال في هذا كفاية واقتداء بالسنة. نعم.
The Sheikh said that the first thing that he wants to mention in the short time that we have remaining, one of the things that he saw from his Sheikh and benefited from him was that the Sheikh would be someone who would return to the truth. If he held an opinion or he gave a fatwa and then he realized that it was incorrect, or he, after studying it more, he realized that the evidence shows something else, he would return back to the truth, and he wasn't shy of doing this. The Sheikh gave an example of this, and that is in the issue of giving your zakah to any type of charity or any type of good deed, whether it's building a masjid or building a hospital or helping the da'wah generally speaking. The Sheikh used to at the beginning say that this is allowed, to give your zakah in this way is allowed, and he would say that it falls under the statement of Allah or under the category of in the path of Allah, fi sabilillah, in the way of Allah, and he would allow it based upon this verse. Then when this issue came to the scholars of the Permanent Committee of Scholars in Saudi Arabia, and the Sheikh studied this issue again with the other shuyukh and so on, they decided that this was incorrect. But rather what is right is that this category is only particular for jihad and the issues that are connected to jihad. That's what the category refers to in terms of zakah. So the Sheikh changed his opinion. And the Sheikh Ali says that this wasn't just the one issue. There were many issues similar to this where the Sheikh, if he came across more evidence, he wouldn't be shy in changing his opinion and going back to the truth. And especially in issues which were recent or issues which were new. When people would come and ask him about issues which had just occurred, he would say, let us study it together in the Permanent Committee of Scholars with all of the other scholars, and then we'll give a single fatwa, we'll give a single verdict and a single answer. The Sheikh says also something which I saw from the Sheikh, another thing which took place was that when Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah used to live in Medina, when he was the Vice Chancellor of the Islamic University of Medina, and he was the Vice Chancellor from the year 1381 when the university was first established until 1395. For this period he was the Vice Chancellor, in effect he was the Chancellor, but the Chancellor on paper was the Mufti, his Sheikh at the time, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Ibrahim rahimahullah. But the Sheikh bin Baz was the one who was actually in Medina, and he was the one running the university. During that time the Sheikh used to call himself Al-Athari. He would say that his name was Abdul Aziz ibn Abdullah ibn Baz Al-Athari, and he would add this title, if you like, or this name Al-Athari towards the end. But then when the Sheikh left Medina and he came back to Riyadh, he stopped using this, but he would rather just use his name, the name of his father and grandfather, Abdul Aziz ibn Abdullah ibn Baz. And he stopped using the word Al-Athari. And Al-Athari means someone who goes back to the Sunnah, goes back to the narrations. The Sheikh says, Sheikh Ali says, I asked him about this. Why did you stop using this title? Why did you stop using this? The Sheikh said, because this title is something which others should call you by. It's not something which you should call yourself by. If others say that this is what you are upon, this is what they call you, then that's okay. But it's not something which you should name for yourself. And that's why the Sheikh after this, he wouldn't call himself Al-Athari or a Salafi or anything like this. But rather he said that what is the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that you name yourself after your father and your grandfather, like he did Abdul Aziz ibn Abdullah ibn Baz. And this is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did as well when he said that I am the grandson or I am the son of Abdul Muttalib. He would name himself with his father and his grandfather. And as for these titles, he said that these are titles that other people should say about you, not something that you should call yourself.
من المواقف التي يذكرها لشيخنا رحمه الله مواقف تدل على إكرامه العلماء وإجلالهم وتعظيمهم التعظيم اللائق بهم، ولو كان بينه وبين هذا العالم خلاف فإنه لا ينزله عن قدره ولا يحط من منزلته ولا يرضى أن يذكر عنده هذا العالم بسوء. من إجلال شيخنا للعلماء أنه في مرضه الأخير، بل قبل أن يموت رحمه الله بأربعين ليلة مات شيخنا وزميله، زميل الشيخ ابن باز أيضا، الشيخ صالح ابن علي ابن غصون، وكان من العلماء الكبار الذي أكثر الناس لا يعرف قدره. توفي إثر مرض الكبد، فاتصلت بشيخنا أعزيه صبيحة ذلك اليوم الذي توفي فيه بعد صلاة الفجر، فقلت أحسن الله عزاءكم وجبر الله مصابنا ومصابكم في أخيك الشيخ صالح بن غصون. قال توفي؟ قلت نعم. قال متى؟ قلت البارحة في أواخر الليل. فدعا له وترحم عليه وسأل الله أن يحسن عزاء المسلمين فيه. سألت شيخنا، قلت هل ستصلون عليه يا سماحة الشيخ؟ سيصلى عليه ظهر ذلك اليوم، لأني سمعت أن امرأة من قريبات الشيخ قد توفيت وسيصلي عليها الشيخ صلاة الظهر في مسجد آخر. فقال نعم سنصلي على أخينا الشيخ صالح. الشيخ صالح ما مثلها أحد، عالم من علماء المسلمين، وبالفعل ترك الصلاة على تلك المرأة في الجماعة وجاء وصلى على الشيخ ابن غصون، ثم قدم على أولاده فعزاهم ودعا للشيخ، ثم رجع بعد ذلك إلى بيته. وهذا من صور إجلال شيخنا واحترامه وإنزاله العلماء منزلتهم اللائقة. وأذكر كلمته لما قال: إن فقد العلماء ليس كفقد غيرهم، وصدق رحمه الله. إن فقد العلماء ليس كفقد غيرهم. وقد قال الإمام الشافعي رحمه الله: إذا ما مات ذو علم وتقوى، إذا ما مات ذو علم وتقوى فقد ثلمت من الإسلام ثلمة. موقف آخر، وأنا وعدتكم بكم موقف يا أخواني؟ 4. أتممنا أو فوينا ما علينا؟ ها؟ موقف أذكره وقد شدني كثيرا، ولا أخفيكم يا أخواني قد أثر في وفي نظرتي إلى العلماء المخالفين، أثر في هذا الموقف تأثيرا كبيرا. حتى العالم المخالف كان شيخنا يحترمه وينزله منزلته اللائقة في خطاباته له أو في محادثته ومشافهته، فيصفه بصاحب الفضيلة: أخونا الشيخ فلان، ولو كان مخالفا له. جاء الشيخ محمد الغزالي عفى الله عنا وعنه في إحدى زياراته للرياض، مشاركا في مؤتمر أو مهرجان، فزار الشيخ ابن باز بعدما ألف كتابه السنة النبوية بين أهل الفقه وأهل الحديث. فلما دخل على شيخنا رحب به واستهل في وجهه وقام له حتى أجلسه عن يمينه، وسأله عن حاله وحال أهله وأولاده وعن شأنه وعما يحتاج إليه. ثم لم يفوت هذه الفرصة أن يناصح الشيخ محمد الغزالي، فقال: يا شيخ محمد، بلغنا كتابك كذا سنة النبوية وقرأناه، ولنا عليه ملاحظات، وأرى أنك قلت فيه كذا وكذا وكذا، وقد أخطأت في كذا. إذن نصح للمخالف له حتى في منهجه، ولم ينزله ذلك عن مرتبة الأخوة في الدين ولا مرتبة أهل العلم وأهل الفضل. وهذا مسلك عز في هذا الزمان، بل ندر إلا من أخذ عن هذا المعين وعن هذا المشرب في تلقي العلم عن أهله، في إنزال الناس منازلهم اللائقة حتى لو كان مخالفا. بل أحد كبار المبتدعة طلب من الشيخ المناظرة، فرحب شيخنا بالمناظرة وقال: أبرك الساعات، إنما نحن وإياك طلاب للحق. فطلب أن تكون المناظرة في مكة وعبر وسائل الإعلام. قال: هذا ما يكون، لسنا ملزمين بأن نضل عباد الله، نتناظر نحن وإياك ها هنا في مكانك أو مكاني في محضر أهل العلم، لا في محضر عوام الناس الذين لا يفهمون أو لا يفقهون أو لا يعرفون. وأمثال هذا كثير يا أخواني. وهذا شأن من سمى بالعلم ورفع الله جل وعلا به شأنه ورفع الله به ذكره. والحديث في مواقف الشيخ كثيرة، الإخوان الحقيقة باغتوني على فجأة وما هيأت كثيرا مما أذكر، ذكرت رؤوس أقلام لكن الوقت أخذنا ولم آتي إلا على نصف ما قيدت في هذه العجالة قبل الصلاة، ولهذا العذر من الله أولا ثم منكم أيها الإخوة ثانيا، سائلا ربي جل وعلا بأسمائه الحسنى وصفاته العلى أن يسلك بنا وبكم صراطه المستقيم، وأن يهدينا بهدايته في الدنيا والآخرة، وأن يجمعنا مع شيخنا ومشايخنا ومع علماء المسلمين ومع صحابة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، ومع نبينا عليه الصلاة والسلام في عليين، وأن يجعلنا ممن يرد حوضه وينال شفاعته ويحشر في لوائه، وممن ينزلهم الله جل وعلا عليين لمحبته لهؤلاء العلماء والأئمة الهداة المهديين الصالحين. ومن يطع الله والرسول فأولئك مع الذين أنعم الله عليهم من النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين، وحسن أولئك رفيقا. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد.
الشيخ جزاه الله خير وبارك الله فيه concluded his lecture by mentioning two last things that he benefited from his sheikh. The first of them was that what he noticed from his sheikh, or something which he gleaned from his sheikh, was the way that Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah ta'ala would have respect for other scholars, and the way that he would revere other scholars, and the way that he would honor other scholars, even if there was a difference of opinion between them. Even if they didn't agree on every point, he would always praise them and he would advise them, and he wouldn't allow other people to talk and speak ill of them. The Sheikh says one of those examples is that towards the end of the life of Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah ta'ala, approximately about 40 days before he passed away, one of his colleagues, one of the people that studied with him, one of the people that grew up with him, a Sheikh, a famous Sheikh by the name of Sheikh Salih al-Ghazun, who was from the great scholars of Riyadh, had passed away. This is 40 days before Sheikh bin Baz himself would pass away. And so Sheikh Ali says that I called the Sheikh to console the Sheikh, to give him condolences at the death of this Sheikh. And the Sheikh had heard that his friend had passed away. And the Sheikh that same day after the Dhuhr prayer was going to pray on one of his relatives. One of his relatives had passed away, and he was going to go and lead the prayer and pray over one of his relatives. But when he heard that his friend and colleague had passed away and the janazah was at the same time, he said that I'm going to go and pray over him instead of my relative. And this was because he said that the Sheikh has more right because of his knowledge, because of what he did for the Muslims, because of his struggling for the Muslims and so on. He has more right that we should pray over him instead. And the Sheikh says that this is an example of the way that Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah would respect the other scholars, the way that he would respect his colleagues, the way that he would respect those people who had knowledge. And the Sheikh would often say that the death of the scholars is unlike the death of anyone else. And Sheikh Ali said that it reminds him of the statement of Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, when he would say that when the people of knowledge and piety pass away, they leave a gap that can't be filled by anyone else. And the Sheikh said that this wasn't just when it came to his friends from the scholars, the Sheikh says, but something else which he himself saw a lot from the Sheikh, something which he benefited greatly from the Sheikh, was that the Sheikh would also respect those people who disagreed with him, or people who maybe had mistakes in their belief and in their methodology. He would still afford them the respect that they deserved. He would still give them the honor that they deserved. And even if he wrote to them advising them, he would call them Sheikh and he would honor them in their title and so on. And he wouldn't be nasty or ill in the way that he addressed them. The Sheikh says that one of the examples of this was when Sheikh Muhammad al-Ghazali came to Riyadh, and he was visiting Riyadh, and he came after he wrote a book about the Sunnah, and there were some mistakes within that book. But when he came and he visited Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah, Sheikh bin Baz welcomed him and he greeted him, and he stood up to go and meet him and greet him, and he made him come and sit on his right, and he spoke to him in a very honorable way. And then at the same time he told him that I read your book, or it was read to me, and there are mistakes that I found in it, and I want to advise you and so on. And this was the way of the Sheikh. Even with those people that he disagreed with, those people that he felt had mistakes, there was a way that he would honor them and the way that he would go about correcting those mistakes. The Sheikh says that another example of this was that there was one of the leaders of innovation once called the Sheikh, and he said that I want to debate with you. And the Sheikh said, okay, I have no problem giving you a debate, because both of us are students searching for the truth. Both of us want to seek the truth. But that man said that I want to debate you in Mecca at a live audience, and I want it to be relayed over the internet. The Sheikh said, no, if you want to debate, if you want to study this issue, come to us and we'll do it privately with only scholars surrounding us. It's not something which we should spread out to the general folk, something which most of them can't comprehend, they don't understand, they don't really know what's going on. This is something which we should do amongst ourselves in private. But again, the way that the Shaykh would approach the situation, the way that he would deal with these people, the Shaykh said, is something which we need to take benefit from. The Shaykh said at the end that there are many, many examples, many, many things that he could go on. He's only gone through about half of what he had written down. And this is just with one of his teachers. He has many other things that he could have gone on to, but time doesn't allow us to go through them. So instead the Shaykh said, and he made dua for us, that Allah Azza wa Jal keeps us firm upon the straight path, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gathers us and our teachers and Shaykh bin Baz rahimahullah, along with the companions and our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Allah Azza wa Jal grants us his intercession on the day of judgment.